So as Peter said, that medical and health robotics has got massive application for robotics. So what I'm going to do here is just give you one example so you can see a tangible example where we think vision and robotics can actually work together. And that's going to be in surgery. So this was the first robotic surgery in 1985. It was a sort of minor procedure to go into someone's brain and actually with a radioactive source burn a little bit of their brain out to treat cancer. So since that point, robots have been used in a number of procedures. And there are kind of three ways that robots are used currently in surgery. There are telerobots. These are robots that are actually controlled by a surgeon. You'll see on the right-hand side there a device called the Da Vinci robot, which some of you may have heard of, where the surgeon sits off to the left there with a sort of a games console and a screen, and the patient is off to the right, and they drive the all the manipulators and camera systems. There are pre-programmed robots, and this first robot that I showed you back here is in that class, where the robot actually is totally pre-programmed and goes in and does its job. And then there's this idea of shared sort of autonomy, where the robot still holds, sorry, the human still holds tools, but the tools will only do the right thing. If a surgeon tries to cut in the wrong place, the cutting device will simply refuse to cut. So we're starting to see some of these kind of smart tools, and they're all based on robotic technology coming into use now. In the surgeries that I've attended in recent months in orthopedics, we actually see commonly used vision systems already. These are used to actually track trackers in people's bones. I've just got some stuff down here, excuse me. Some bones, always have props. So currently the vision is used in surgery when doing, say, knee surgery. The surgeon wants to know where the knees are, where the bones are if they're doing a knee replacement. They put tracking devices into the bones. They actually screw them into the bones. And then they're actually tracked by a vision system you see there on the left. So that's been used for quite a long time now, probably 7 or 8 years in surgery, and it's become quite common. So you'll see vision is already getting into surgery. What we want to do is actually have systems where you don't need artificial markers. So that's one obvious application. And also start to actually use vision in the loop. So back here, some sort of angles of the bones are put up on a screen, and the surgeon is still doing all the manipulation and just tries to make these numbers say the right thing. What the next step will be to actually have the vision system in the control loop and have some sort of robot manipulators or tools actually controlled via the vision system. So one thing we're going to try first, and this is the first project we're starting, is robotic knee arthroscopy. Now, knee arthroscopy, hang on a second, is a procedure where it's a closed procedure, so it's minimally invasive procedure. This is a camera, it's shoved into your knee. Another tool is shoved into your knee on the other side, and the surgeon is there then holding these two, a camera and a tool. They're also holding your leg, and they're moving your leg around, and they have a foot pedal where they're controlling the cutting tool. So it's like they're almost a drummer. They're using almost everything they can possibly use. It's a very difficult procedure, and they could really do with some assistance and some robotic assistance. The key piece of technology required to turn this procedure into a robotic procedure is a vision system. So it's absolutely essential that the system sees what's going on. So there's a couple of things here: camera and tool navigation. You need to the robot system needs to understand what's happening in the knee joint. So we actually need to do some live 3D mapping. It also needs to control the instruments using its vision sensor. So the vision sensor at the end of this tool here, the data's got to come back to the manipulator that's moving it around, and there's a control loop there. And then there's one bigger control loop, which is the leg manipulation system. These sorts of procedures will actually require a robot to hold the leg. And that leg will move around, and it actually opens up the joint. So just another example here. You can't actually get into this joint when your leg's like this. The surgeons currently bend your leg. You're asleep, so you don't notice this. They bend your leg and actually open up the joint if they get in that side, and open it up if they want to get in that side, and they move it around like this. So the robot system would need to manipulate the leg while controlling controlling the tools, and it would actually be seeing how it's going with the vision system in the end of the camera. This is my last slide. So some people have been, as we've started this kind of project, people are saying, isn't it too hard? And the answer is yes, that's why we're doing it. We've decided to be bold. This is something that will take a long time, maybe actually beyond the length of the centre. Maybe we'll get a refunded centre. But there should be things that will spin off as we go along, so assistance technologies that current surgeons can have. One of the competitive advantages we've got here is we have world-leading orthopaedic surgeons in the team, and we have access to the Medical Engineering Research Facility, which was a Smart State-funded facility about 7 or 8 years ago, which is at the Prince Charles Hospital campus. So this actually allows us to do experiments on cadavers and on animals such as pigs. So we actually have a little bit of an advantage over others that would attempt this work. So that's just one example. There's many examples of projects in medical and health robotics, and we'll be exploring those in the coming months. Okay, thank you.